Hey, welcome to church, everybody. Let's stand together. Let's sing to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords who reigns forever. Let's give him everything we've got. He deserves it. Let's sing this out together.
Take a seat, Arvis. My name is Ramirez. I serve as the Associate Campus Pastor here at our Rolling Meadows campus. And man, welcome. Isn't it great to be in God's house with God's people on the Lord's Day, worshiping Him together because He reigns forever. And if this is your first time joining us, I want to extend a very special welcome to you. And just know that you're amongst a welcoming people, okay? And I'm one of them. I'm going to be in the lobby after church. I love the opportunity to meet you and see how I can serve you while you're here at Harvest. Harvest, I need for you to pull your phones out right now. Do it. This is a community moment that we all get to partake in. We get to all log into the Harvest Bible Chapel app together right now and check in. It not only allows us to know that you're here today, but you can click on the prayer request as well. Because during this time of season, you know, some people are lonely and you might need prayer. And we are a church family that bears one another's burdens, and we want to come alongside you in prayer. So you can submit a prayer request while you're there. You can also get connected in community. And if you don't have the Harvest Bible Chapel app, you can scan the QR code on the seat in the row in front of you. And it allows us to better care for the people in our church. All right, Harvest, next week is Christmas, right? Everyone agree? Everyone know that. It's 8 days away, all right? And so everyone knows that, right? But you might not know about the service time changes, okay? So listen up, because it's a major change for you, all right? We will continue with our Saturday night services at 5 o'clock. However, next week, Sunday, Christmas Eve, we're only doing one service, and that's at 10 a.m. Okay, so we're all going to gather together in here at 10 a.m. next week. And then Sunday night is our annual candlelight service. Now, this service is an awesome service to invite someone to who may not know the Lord. So maybe a coworker, a neighbor, or a relative. Okay, so we have next week, Christmas Eve at 10 a.m., and then the candlelight service at 5 p.m. Harvest, the Lord is constantly moving in our church. And I know for me, being on staff, just serving the Lord week to week and event after event and class after class, you can sometimes forget about God's goodness in that and what he's doing in the ministries here at Harvest. And so knowing that that is true for me, I'm assuming it might be true for you too. So it's healthy for us to just stop and reflect on what the Lord is doing. And so we figured out the best way to do that is through a video. So check out this video.
I enter the courts of a Father who knows my name, who opens the heavens wide when I start to praise. And I come with a testimony of miracles, of a God who has overcome the impossible.
How much more? Well, the answer to that question is much more. We're trusting that the Lord will do much more in 2024. And so let's pray about that. Let's reflect on what the Lord has done, but let's just pray about what he has in store for us in 2024 as well. Lord, we thank you for who you are. Your grace and mercy endures forever. Lord, you are so good to us. We don't deserve it, but yet and still, you are so good. And so, Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for your grace and kindness towards us and towards our church. We thank you for everything that you've done in 2023, but Lord, we are thanking you and praising you for everything that you are yet to do. We love you, Lord. Lord, will you continue to provide all the needs of our church? continue to open our hearts each week as we open up your word together. Lord, continue to move in our presence this morning and forevermore. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's stand to our feet and continue to worship, guys.
Resting in his mother's arms. Ooh.
the Lord together in communion today. So I'd just like to invite the communion teams to come forward and start passing out the elements. And communion is something that we celebrate every month as the gathered body of Christ. And it's this beautiful commemorative meal that Christ has given us to remember the covenant that we have, the union that we have with God, the peace that we have with God, the forgiveness that we have through Christ. And especially here in the month of December, as we're in the season of what's called Advent in the Christian calendar, which really is a word that means that we're looking with coming expectation. As the people of God were before Christ came, they were expectant that God was gonna come. And now as we look back, we can see that actually Christ did come, that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, that we might have a way to enter into the presence of God and to have relationship with God once again. So we're gonna spend a little bit of time this morning around the communion table. And what I'd like to encourage you to do is not to miss or not to forget the fact that God is here among us, that the manifest presence of God through His Holy Spirit is right here among us, as He has promised that every time His people gather, He is here. And if you come today and you need healing, if you come today because you are carrying grief or sorrow or loss, or you come today because you have some deficit in your spirit, the word of the Lord to you today is that you are blessed, because the kingdom of heaven belongs to those who are poor in spirit. And at the table of God, all are invited and all are recipients of the same grace. John chapter 8 and verse 12, Jesus says, "I am the light of the world, and whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." God, would your glory reign? Would it shine like the day? Would we know how we have been delivered from the kingdom of darkness, where we were blind and we couldn't see and we didn't know our way around? But you have stepped in and given us light. In you is life. Who else could we go to? You have the words of eternal life. And so even right now, God, we come to you. We come to worship you. We come to ascribe our praise to you. Would you fill our hearts with gratefulness? Would you fill our hearts, Lord, for those who need to comfort in your presence. Holy Spirit, would you fall? Would you comfort those who are hurting today? And would we all remember the grace that we have been given in Jesus Christ? Would it result in just praise and surrender? We bring ourselves to you.
In light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you.
What a hope that is.
So here I am to worship. Here I am.
with our spirits, with our bodies, with our minds, with our hearts, with all of us. God, in spirit and in truth, we come to worship today. The Lamb who is worthy. The one who was born to give us second birth, as the great hymn text says. And so, friends, let's take the bread today, remembering that Christ came and took on flesh, and that his body was given for us. Let's take the bread. Not only did he come and live a sinless life, but he also laid down that life, and he died so that you might have forgiveness of sins and relationship with God. And let's take the cup this morning, remembering what Christ has done for us.
Now never know how
you that we have an opportunity to remember all that you've done for us, not just on the cross, but throughout each of our lives, the ways that you have showed up, the ways you've been faithful. Lord, I pray that would give us hope for the future. Pray that we remember that faithfulness is part of your nature. Lord, would we look at who you are this morning? Would we respond in gratitude? Would we respond in praise and adoration? Would we respond in repentance? Turn our hearts to you, turn our affections to you this morning as we look into your word. And would we walk out having grown that much closer to you? In this precious name of prayer, amen. Church, it's so good to be together, isn't it? As we turn our attention to the screen, why don't you have a seat and say hi to someone next to you?
Good morning, Harvest. Good to be with you this morning. My name is Cory. I am the new campus pastor over in the North Shore in Highland Park. And thank you for the welcome. I appreciate that a lot. It's actually really great to be with you. We arrived here, my wife and I, in mid-August, started at the beginning of September. And we're excited to be a part of the team at Harvest. It's a really great place to do ministry. Love being here, enjoy the whole place that we live and the church family we're a part of. A little shout out to my North Shore family right now that's probably watching, I would assume, right now as well, and all the other campuses that are joining us online too. Glad that you could join us this morning. You know, before we open the word, I want to just say a brief word to all of us regarding just, I guess, a word of gratitude, if I can put it that way, about your faithful giving. Because I don't know if you're aware of this, but when we faithfully give, it has a kingdom impact. And that kingdom impact certainly is felt over in the North Shore as well. Now, how is that? Well, because as a church, Harvest, we are all about mission, right? We're all about being the kind of people that are on mission and going with the gospel and planting healthy churches. That's what we want to see happen. And one of the ways we're doing that right now is we are working through the process of relaunching the North Shore. So we're a little campus at this point, but we're trusting that God's going to do some amazing things over in the North Shore. A lot of people need the Lord everywhere we go. And so we're just trusting that he's going to do some great things there. And I just want to say that when we give and we lean in together, we can do incredible things for God on mission. And so I'm just excited to see what happens. And I just wanted to have an opportunity to say thank you for that. I also wanted to just let you know just really quickly that, you know, we're getting to the end of the year, right? 2023 is almost in the books. And just can I encourage you just to sort of lean in a little bit more in the giving area, perhaps pray carefully about giving the end of the year. We have $1.4 million left. Together we can do this, right? We can do this. Let's start off 2024 strong, shall we? Could we just have a word of prayer before we open up the word, though? Father, this morning, so grateful. You are so good. Jesus, we just sang about how much we love you, and we do. And Lord, we love your word. And Lord, as we open your word this morning, would you grow us in our knowledge and understanding, but also in our love and affection for you?
Give us ears to hear what your Spirit has to say to us. Give us the eyes to see. Lord, give us hearts that are soft and pliable for you. For we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, over the last couple of weeks, we've been in a series here at Harvest entitled, What Christmas Says About God. And we've seen over the last couple of weeks, first of all, that God is generous, and last week, that God is near. And this week, we're going to talk about how God is faithful, how God is faithful. And I want to share with you, we're going to dive right into this message because I have a lot of scripture that I want to cover. We're going to be in a number of different places in the Word of God this morning as we talk about God being faithful. And I want to share with you three ways in particular that God is really faithful. In particular, how Christmas shows us that God is faithful. So if you're following along in any kind of notes or anything like that, I want you to note it, first of all, that God is faithful to His promises. God is so faithful to the promises that He made. Now, I don't know if any of you have ever done this. My suspicion is maybe not. You've probably, some of you, read through the entire Bible from beginning to end, which is awesome. But have you ever read from the beginning to end with this one thing in mind, reading specifically to count how many promises are mentioned in Scripture? You know, others have done this. They've come up with numbers like this, 8,810 promises. That's a lot of promises. You see, in God, what we see in Scripture is a promise-making God, and He's a promise-keeping God, isn't He? And His promises are found early on in the Word of God, and they go all through Scripture. And when we talk about Christmas, we talk about the birth of Jesus, how can you not talk about God's faithfulness with regards to the predictions in the Old Testament about the coming of Jesus, the promises that He made from the very beginning all the way through. Now, His first promise to us is found all the way back in the very beginning, and sometimes you wonder, what in the world does Genesis chapter 3 have to do with the Christmas story? But it actually has everything to do with it. In Genesis chapter 3, we read the account of Adam and Eve, how they had sinned in the garden. In fact, we were there last week, and Pastor Tommy talked about how God is near. We started near, but we drifted far. And there in Genesis chapter 3, when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, what happened? Right after that, God gives them hope. God doesn't write them off and say, that's it, I'm no longer going to try with humanity. No, God rather in His faithfulness gives a promise right there in Genesis chapter 3, a promise of something in the future. I want you to see this in Genesis 3, verse 14 and 15, in particular when He, with regards to His comments to the serpent, when He punishes the serpent, here's what He says, "The Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and above all the beasts of the field. On your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. And here is the key. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise," or in some translations, "crush your head, and you shall bruise his heel." Perhaps you've looked at this promise before, but what exactly is the promise that's being given in this passage right after the fall of Adam and Eve? It's really a promise of redemption that will come. The text, you see, speaks of this ongoing enmity that would exist between the offspring of the woman and the offspring of the serpent. What happens in Genesis from this time forward and all through biblical history is this. There is the emergence immediately of two different lines. There's a godly line, if you will, and an ungodly line. It begins already with Cain and Abel, doesn't it? When Cain kills Abel. And then Abel has somebody else who comes along. Adam and Eve have another son named Seth. And from Seth, what happens? It's eventually from Seth that Abraham comes. And then after Abraham, Isaac and Jacob and the 12 tribes of Israel. And out of the 12 tribes, you have Judah that's selected. And eventually, ultimately, it leads us to someone, doesn't it? It leads us to the person of Jesus. But at the same time, there's another line going all throughout history, this ungodly line that's often in opposition to God. So from the offspring of this woman, though, we're told that there will be a future male descendant who will arise. And notice what it says. It's singular masculine. He shall bruise or crush your head. He's going to crush the head of the serpent. That is, the male descendant of the woman shall crush the head of the serpent. But when would that happen? This passage traditionally is understood in Christian circles in history as a reference to Jesus Christ when he came into this world. Many would point it to the time on the cross when he hung up on the cross and the serpent sort of nipped at his heel, as this text says, but Jesus crushed the head of the serpent. Ultimately, we know in the New Testament that this finds its fulfillment when Jesus, in his current rule and current reign over all the kingdoms of the world, is right now working to put all of his enemies under his feet. So that eventually, according to Romans 16:20, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. You see, this promise is eventually found, fully fulfilled, and realized in Jesus. Now, there are many promises that we could go through this morning, and we certainly don't have time for 8,810 of them, do we? But you see, this descendant that comes from Eve eventually comes through the line of King David. And I want to zone in this morning on one of the promises that God made to David in particular. In the Old Testament, God made so many promises, and they were in the form of covenants or agreements. And in one place in particular, he made a covenant with David. It's known as the Davidic covenant. And in that passage, we find it in 2 Samuel 7, God spoke these words to the prophet Nathan regarding King David. We find it in 2 Samuel chapter 7, and I'm going to read from verses 12 through 17. And I want you to note that this is approximately 1,000 years before Christ. 1,000 years before Christ. Nathan says to David, when your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, so he's about to pass away, or when that day comes, I will raise up, God says, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. When he commits iniquity, I will discipline him with a rod of men, with the stripes of the Son of Men. But my steadfast love will not depart from him, as I took it from Saul when I put away from before you. And your house, he says, and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. In accordance with all these words, and in accordance with all this vision, Nathan spoke to David. If you read this passage by itself and you're not sure of its connection into the future, you could easily miss the glorious truths that are in the scripture and how they roll forward into the future and find their incredible fulfillment in the person of Jesus Christ, which we will look at in a moment. You see, in this covenant that God made to David, he says to David that, David, this isn't going to happen in your lifetime, but when you die, when you lie down with your fathers, you will have a house. No, not a 3,000 or 4,000 square foot home that you're going to go and live in. It's a different kind of house. It's referred to as a dynasty. There will be a Davidic or dynasty of King David, and there will be also a kingdom. In other words, there will be this realm over which the king will rule, and there will be a throne that will exist, and that throne will last forever. Now, it's really important when we look at this text to ask ourselves, well, who does this text actually apply to? You see, if it doesn't apply to David in particular, it's referring to one of his descendants, then who could that possibly be? Well, it's certainly true that aspects of this Davidic covenant would be directly applicable to David's next son, Solomon. You see, because Solomon came right after. And Solomon, indeed, is the one who built, as this text says, a house or a temple for God We see that in 1 Kings chapter 6. It's also applicable to Solomon because verse 14 clearly states that when he commits iniquity, I will discipline him. We know as the story of Solomon unfolds in Scripture that that's exactly what happened with King Solomon. He committed iniquity. So on one level, this text does refer to David's direct son, who's the descendant. But it has to be more than that. You see, it can't simply apply to Solomon for a couple of reasons. First of all, if you notice in this text, the word forever is used. Solomon has come and gone. He will not last forever. And the use of the word forever in this text shows that the covenant that God made with David extends beyond Solomon. It refers to some descendant that's even beyond the years of Solomon. And secondly, this covenant itself is referred to later on in the Bible. As years unfold, this language of this covenant gets retold over and over again. And in one particular case that we'll look at in a moment, 300 years later, still predicting and referring to the promise of this descendant coming, this son of David who would arrive. So in approximately 700 BC, that is 300 years after God spoke to David through the prophet Nathan, God then spoke to the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 and 7, and he said these words, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this." Notice the language in this passage. You see, if you just read this passage and it was disconnected from 2 Samuel 7, you could really miss a lot. You see, this passage is simply reiterating, telling us again 300 years later that that promise has not yet been fulfilled, but a son is coming, and that son, this individual, who will have the government rest upon his shoulders, and he will be on David's throne. And there will be an increase of his government and of peace. This will happen from this time forth and forevermore. And notice it ends in this passage with, "The zeal of the Lord will accomplish this." You see, God is passionate to bring about his own promises because he's faithful. God's going to do this. He promised it to David and David's descendant. In Isaiah 9, we find the promise emerge again. And we learn of this descendant, of what he should be like. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, not in the counselor sense, like you go to somebody and you lay on the couch and you talk to them about your problems. It's counselor rather in probably more of a military kind of a sense, an advisor. Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. This is who he is. You see, what God said then to David in 2 Samuel does have its initial fulfillment in his son Solomon, but what God said to David clearly refers to a more distant descendant of David, doesn't it? Well, let's continue to see how this text unfolds. Who does this prophecy refer to? I think we all know that we're heading to Jesus, don't we? You see, the answer is actually found 700 years later, roughly. In approximately 6 BC. Now, we know that King Herod died in 4 BC. We know that to be a historical fact. And we know that King Herod was the one in Matthew chapter 2 who wanted to have all of the children 2 years of age and under killed, didn't he? So we know that Jesus was born before 4 BC. So somewhere in the neighborhood maybe of 6 BC, this is just an approximation, we know that an angel came to Mary 700 years after the prophecy to Isaiah. And we read in Luke chapter 1 these words, "In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, 'Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you.' But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son.'" Now, as we read this passage, remember 2 Samuel 7 and remember Isaiah chapter 9. He says, "And you shall call his name Jesus," in verse 31. In verse 32, "He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." That's Jesus. "And Mary said to the angel, 'How will this be, since I am a virgin?' And the angel answered, 'The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God.'" This text tells us that Jesus is the future descendant of David that 2 Samuel 7 and Isaiah chapter 9 had predicted. Right here in this text, in Luke chapter 1, the promise is given to Mary that her son, who is a legal descendant of David, will be given the throne of David, and he will rule over the kingdom and the house of David forever. There will be no end. When Jesus was on earth, what did he do? He preached about the kingdom of God, didn't he? He constantly talked about the rule of God. The king had appeared. The king was among us. The king walked among the people. And when Jesus was crucified, it was a shock to the people of the time. Why? Because the people of that time had expectations that were different than what Jesus knew he had come to do and what Scripture actually taught in the Old Testament. You see, many had expected Jesus, the Messiah, or I should say the Messiah period, to come and to be a ruling, reigning, conquering king who would smash the Romans. But Jesus didn't do that. He said, "My kingdom is not of this world." And to a great shock, even to his own disciples, he was crucified and buried. And then even with greater surprise and joy, he was raised to life again. So how is it then that these passages can relate to Jesus? How do they apply? Certainly they are clearly at his birth referring to how he's the fulfillment of all of this. There's no question about that. But when did Jesus occupy the throne? Is he over the kingdom or not? To answer this question, we must turn to Acts chapter 2, because shortly after Jesus resurrected and ascended into heaven, the Apostle Peter stood up on the day of Pentecost and preached this message, starting in verse 29. He said, "Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne." See that line right there. Luke tells us when he writes the book of Acts here that David knew that God had sworn with an oath back in 2 Samuel chapter 7 that he would set one of his descendants on the throne. He foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, that is the grave, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses, being therefore exalted at the right hand of God. You see, this passage declares to us that it was then in the ascension of Jesus that Jesus is on the throne of David and that he is ruling over his kingdom. Right now, Jesus is in this exalted position where he is right now our ruling, reigning, conquering King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And one of the things Scripture makes clear as you get into the New Testament is that Jesus, in this exalted position that he is in, seated in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, is that he is right now working to put his enemies underneath his feet. And he will continue to do that until all the enemies are vanquished, all the enemies are put under his feet, and the last enemy to be put asunder is death itself. And when that happens, there will be a resurrection. And one of those enemies that needs to be put asunder is the one way back in Genesis 3. The one that Adam, quite frankly, should have stomped on and crushed his head, but he let him in the garden. There's coming a day, friends, when our ruling, reigning, conquering king will bring all things to a finality, and the fulfillment of this Davidic promise in Genesis 3 will all come to bear when Jesus finally puts all those enemies under his feet. When you put all of these texts together, you can see that Jesus is the Son of David, a legal son, that he's referred to as the Son of God in this messianic sense, that he's over the house, kingdom, and throne of David. He sits down on David's throne when he ascends into heaven, and he rules on that throne forever. There will never be an end to the kingdom. He will continue. And what he's doing right now is he's working in and through the church. You see, when he ascended on high in Acts, what did he do? He sent his Spirit to the church, right? And he unleashed the church to go with this message, the message of the good news that Jesus Christ, the Son of David, the Messiah, has come into the world. He is the Savior of the world. Now, church, go with that message. And he goes with us. Now, I put together this little, I suppose, handy-dandy little chart, if you can read it, that all it does is just really compare the text that I've referred to this morning. Sometimes I find it, just for me personally, a little bit of a helpful visual to see the distance between left and right in terms of the promise that God made and the fulfillment of God's promises, starting with 2 Samuel 7 in 1000 B.C., 300 years later, 700 B.C., Isaiah chapter 9, 4 B.C., roughly, Luke 1, and then in A.D. 33, 35, roughly, in Acts chapter 2, after the day of, on the day of Pentecost. You see, all of that is part of God's grand scheme of things where he made promises and he brought them to fulfillment. And if you take some time in your own personal study just to look at each of these texts, I would encourage you to do so and just see how they're all so intricately connected. God is in all of the details of his promises. You see, what God promised long ago has indeed been fulfilled with precision in the birth of Jesus Christ. And when God promises something, he's faithful to bring it to pass. This tells us that God is not only faithful, but he's trustworthy, isn't he? He's true. It not only tells us something about the character of God, but it also tells us about this, the Word of God, doesn't it? It tells us that this book, the Bible, is something you and I can trust because this is given to us by God, inspired by God, inerrant. We can go to the Word of God and we can read in its pages and we can understand and we can see how Scripture that was predicting things came to pass with precision. It's one of the many things that reveal to us how the Word of God is actually literally the very words of God, not made by man. You know, the Bible has a whole pile of other prophecies and predictions that are made about a whole host of other things. Just for the sake of interest, there's 16 more that I'm
throwing on the screen for you this morning that we're not going to go through, but I just want you to note them. You see, 16 different prophecies regarding the Messiah that range from his birth all the way to his resurrection and reign in glory, all of them fulfilled with precision in the New Testament. It would actually be absolutely impossible for one individual to try to make this happen on their own, to sort of concoct this, to fulfill this on their own. This was clearly God's hand at work. I mean, he's born of a woman, born of a virgin, of the seed of Abraham. You can't plan to where you're going to be born and to whom you'll be born. But Jesus fulfills all of these because this was part of God's divine plan. It talks about his death in Old Testament, how he would die. It talks about his resurrection and his ascension into heaven and how he'd sit down at the right hand of God. You see, this and many more. These are just 16. Norman Geisler, a number of years ago in his book, When Skeptics Ask, made this comment. He said, mathematicians have calculated the probability of 16 predictions being fulfilled in one man at 1 in 10 to the 45th power. So 45 zeros behind it. That's a lot. I'm no mathematician, okay? I would never know how to even figure that out, honestly, right? I just wouldn't. That's not my wheelhouse. I sort of look at that and I say, that's incredible. The point is, that's not going to happen unless God does that. God makes that happen. You see, all of this is to encourage us with the truth that whatever God promises, he's faithful to see that his word and promise are fulfilled. Christmas is a time that we can see his faithfulness up close in how he brought so many of his promises to precise fulfillment with the birth of Jesus Christ, the Messiah. Friends, if all of that is true, and it is, then we connect that to our own lives to say, that's reality. And there are people that need to know that. There are people that need to know that. So that's the first thing. The second thing I want you to see is that God is faithful to his plan. So he's faithful to his promises. You've seen those, some of them. He's also faithful to his plan. Galatians chapter 4 is a wonderful text. We read in this passage that when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. And notice the purpose for which he did this, to redeem those who are under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. The point in this passage, when it says the fullness of time had come, that's when God did this. It wasn't going to happen any time before that. The word fullness in this text is maybe similar to having a cup maybe of water and filling it up to the absolute top so that, you know, sometimes you can fill it so the water is actually slightly above the rim. Have you ever noticed that? But if you were to add one more drop, it would overflow. You know, these prophecies, these predictions weren't going to happen any time until it was absolutely full. Not another drop could happen. And God was orchestrating that in his providence. In his sovereignty, God was over all of that. He was the one who selected the right time for Jesus to be born. Implied in all that is God's plan. He's faithful to his plan. Specific things had to happen then, didn't they? Historically, when we look at this, much to probably the surprise of the people back in that day, they wouldn't really have seen that this was God's hand at work. They would have just been doing their things. But when we look back on history, we can certainly see that God in his sovereignty was orchestrating the coming of Jesus by making certain things happen historically to set the stage for the birth of Jesus, the Messiah. We can thank both Greek and Roman conquest of back in the day because Latin and Greek were known across the empire. Well, what does that have to do with anything? It has actually a lot to do with it, you see, because now that there's sort of this common language or universal language, it enabled what? It enabled when Jesus came for those who are his disciples to take the message of the gospel and spread it like it never had been spread before because of that. Because now people had access through language.
We're told that the Roman roads at that time, the Romans created such an infrastructure. And if you've been over in that area at all of the world, you know that those roads were designed and constructed in such a way that some of them have even survived to this very day. You can walk on some of them still. Those roads enabled the Romans to move about freely. They had different designs and purposes, of course, but God had different designs and purposes for those roads. The Romans, you see, developed this efficient postal system. In fact, on this, R.C. Sproul even said perhaps they should, the American government should learn something from that. It is impossible, you see, to conceive of the rapid expansion of the gospel of the early Christian church apart from these sort of cultural advantages. It was because the infrastructure was put in place that the word of God, the written word of God, could be spread throughout the land, that the messengers of the gospel could spread throughout the land, that because of the shared language, it could be spread throughout the land, all because it was when the fullness of time come, God had the right time. You see, God isn't sitting in heaven, wringing his hands, thinking, oh my goodness, people are doing this, and people are doing that, and I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to have to respond. Oh, I didn't see that coming. This person just did this. This ruler just said this. Now I've got to react. God is not a reacting God. He's a sovereign God who rules and reigns over all, and he's already had a plan in place from eternity past, and he's bringing it to fulfillment with precision, right down to the details of those Roman roads. God is faithful. He's faithfully unfolded his plan so that he could bring his son into the world to accomplish what verse 5 tells us, to redeem, and to adopt. There was a time when I was not in the family of God, and I would assume there's a time for you when you are not in the family of God, and maybe you're not this morning. But he came to redeem, that is to purchase, to buy back, to get us out of the slave market, the slavery to sin, to redeem us from that and to bring us into his family, to be adopted into his family. That happened for me on July 25th, 1987. My goodness, that's a long time ago now. And I trust if it hasn't happened for you, you would know this morning that God is faithful. And he did all of this. The faithfulness to his promises and the faithfulness that we see to his own plan, all because he wants to see you redeemed. He wants you to be part of his family. So God is indeed faithful to his promises. He's faithful to his plan. But lastly, thirdly, I want you to see that God is faithful to his people. And in many respects, that's what I've been saying for the last while here in this message, is really it boils down to this. All of this is that God is so faithful to us as his people. And he's faithful to us in two ways in particular. First of all, he's faithful to us even in times when we're not faithful to him. I want you to think, since we've spent so much time in the Old Testament and looking forward to the Old Testament, how it leads us into the time of Jesus, I want you to think about Israel's history in the Old Testament. If you know the Old Testament, you know that Israel has a checkered history, doesn't it? They have seasons of obedience, and then they have seasons of disobedience. Sometimes you read the Old Testament, and you shake your head, and you think, you guys are a bunch of knuckleheads. And then you look in the mirror, and you realize, oh, I guess I'm one too. You see, as a result of their disobedience, we know historically and we know scripturally that the Assyrians came in and attacked Israel in 722 BC and dragged them off into exile. We know that the Babylonians came in 586, 587, and they dragged Judah off, taking them to captivity for 70 years outside of their land. We know that at the time of Jesus, Israel was occupied by the Romans. You see, many of these things, Scripture tells us the reason why. It's because Israel had fallen into adultery. They had failed to be faithful to God. But what I want you to see this morning is that in their faithfulness or faithlessness at times, God didn't kick his people to the side. He remained faithful to them all the way through their history. But in God's faithfulness to us, that doesn't mean that he just sort of ignores when we're not faithful to him. You see, the Bible tells us in the Old Testament, in Proverbs, as well as Hebrews 12, that those who are his children, those who belong to him or part of his family, the Lord will discipline. And that's what God did with Israel in the Old Testament. He disciplined them, didn't he? When they sinned, when they were unfaithful to God, God remained faithful. And one of the ways he expressed his faithfulness to them was to stay in it with them and to say, you are my people, but I'm going to discipline you because my heart's desire is that you would turn back to me. And so God would discipline them, and they would turn back. And then they would wander, and then they would turn back. And then they would wander, and then they would turn back. And the story unfolds like that all through the Old Testament, doesn't it? And friends, we're really not all that different, are we? Maybe you're here this morning and you can say, you know, I'm not sure what you're talking about. I faithfully follow the Lord every second, 24/7, 365. Thank you. I want to meet you after the service. I would love to know your secret. You know, one thing I know from my own life is that that's just not true. Oh, I desire to, but boy, we are at war with our own flesh, with a world that is the system of evil and the devil rage against us. And we do find ourselves time and time again, maybe for a brief moment, maybe for seasons even, where we are somewhat unfaithful to the Lord. Maybe we've allowed things in our lives like Israel did. We allow maybe a form of idolatry. Some kind of idol creeps into our lives. Not wood and stone, but something else that we give of ourselves to, our devotion to. It could be anything. This morning, you know in your heart, if you're walking in faithfulness to the Lord, what I want you to hear this morning is that God is still faithful to you. And he would much rather you turn back and walk in faithfulness with him so that he doesn't have to discipline you as his son or daughter. That's how God is with us. That's how much he loves us. The second thing I want you to know about God's faithfulness to his people is that he's faithful even when we feel like he's given up on us. Sometimes it's not because maybe a sin in our lives or a lack of faithfulness on our part. Sometimes we go through seasons in our lives, and sometimes those seasons stretch pretty long. And we often refer to them as waiting for God to fulfill promises. And in those times, we can begin to question God's faithfulness. You see, that's actually what gets expressed in Psalm 89. And I want to take you to Psalm 89 just for a couple of minutes, because Psalm 89 is directly connected in and tied in with the Davidic covenant. Psalm 89 is written by a guy named Ethan the Ezrahite. Ethan writes the psalm because something has happened sort of in the historical background of the day that has caused him to be a little beside himself. He looks in at sort of the promise that God made to David in 2 Samuel 7, that he would have a throne and a kingdom, and this kingdom would be forever. And now he looks in and he says, Lord, what gives? Because I don't see that. It looks to me like you've just forsaken us. In Psalm 89, he begins by saying, I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever. With my mouth, I'll make known your faithfulness to all generations. So with his mouth, he's confessing this to be true. He knows that God said he's faithful, so God is faithful. Notice that he said, for I said, steadfast love will be built up forever in the heavens. You will establish your faithfulness. Now he reminds God of what God said. And that's kind of what we do sometimes, right? When we're in the midst of struggle. You said, God... You have said, and what did God say? I have made a covenant with my chosen. I have sworn to David, my servant, I will establish your offspring forever and build your house for all generations. In the rest of this psalm, from chapter 89, verse 1, all the way down to 37, he retells how of old, in 2 Samuel, God made this promise to David and to David's offspring forever. Down in verse 31 or 32, he says that he will not remove from David his steadfast love or be false to his faithfulness. He will not violate his covenant or alter the word that went forth from his lips. Once for all, I have sworn by my holiness, I will not lie to David. His offspring shall endure forever. His throne, as long as the sun before me, like the moon, it shall be established forever. I mean, it seems pretty clear. What Ethan is saying is, God, I'm reminding you of what you said. You said your promise to David is, as long as the sun endures, as long as there's a moon, this promise is true. But notice the shift in verse 38. But now you have cast off and rejected. You are full of wrath against your anointed. You've renounced the covenant. You've defiled the crown. You've breached all the walls. You've laid hold his strongholds. You have exalted the right hand. You have done this. You have done this. And you have done this. Every verse begins with, you've done this. 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 God, you have just abandoned and forsaken your promises to me. Or to David. So he's in a significant conflict. And friends, that's where we find ourselves sometimes, isn't it? The conflict between what God promised and the sort of the real rub of reality in life, where we find ourselves in situations where we're waiting and God's not bringing it to fulfillment or to pass. And in those moments, we can really begin to question God and his faithfulness. But what this psalmist does, what Ethan does, is he comes full circle in this psalm, and in verse 49, he said, Lord, where is your steadfast love, which by your faithfulness you swore to David? Remember, O Lord, remember. You see, he's calling upon God to remember. And the reality of this is that God has always been faithful, even though Ethan, the Ezrahite, could not see it in that moment. Because that promise that God made to David, though it took long and there were years of waiting, God brought about his promises and he fulfilled his plan and he did it all for his people. God could see what Ethan couldn't see. A number of years ago, my wife and I planted a church in Utah. It was in 2003, and we left that plant in 2015. It was an amazing adventure, like still an incredible highlight in our life. And I honestly thought to myself when I left the church plant that I would find another church to pastor, like really quick. I really didn't think otherwise. I started applying at churches, but God had a radically different plan. And it was hard. He sidelined me for 5 years. Instead of quickly moving on, he left me in what felt like a wilderness, quite frankly. I did jobs that I really did not want to do. I was like, God, you didn't call me to this. Are you abandoning me now? Are you forsaking me? Have you cast me aside? And I'm no longer of worth and value to you. Am I no longer of use in the ministry? Am I just sort of sidelined? All the no's and rejections that I got from churches of feeling like you're too old or you're too whatever, or you don't fit the list of qualifications because we're looking for a guy that's just like Jesus. You're like, good luck finding him. All I can say is, at the right time, with all of my agonizing and struggling and walking that out, at the jobs that I was at and going for walks always, and I didn't walk faithfully in the sense of, I wish I could tell you that in all the waiting, I waited like a champ. I mean, I waited in such a way that I prayed and I fasted and I did all the right things that one should do when they're waiting. No, I learned the hard way what waiting was like. And I struggled. I struggled. And then all of a sudden, God cracked open the sky. His timing was perfect. And I don't have the time to explain to you all the things that he did, but it was truly amazing what the Lord did. And I can honestly look back now and I can say I fully understand those 5 years of waiting, what God was doing. And friends, sometimes when you and I are waiting for things, that's the way it is for us. But often it comes to us only in hindsight that we can see that God was providentially orchestrating his plan. So what I want you to know this morning as we close is that if you're waiting, God has not forsaken you. He's faithful to you. He's faithful to his promises. And just as he was faithfully unfolding his plan so that he could accomplish the purpose of bringing Jesus into the world at the right time, so he's faithful to you in your life. And he has a plan for your life as well. In chapter 3 of the book of Lamentations, it's a book called Lamentations because there's a lot of lamenting. It's a tough time for Israel. And Jeremiah says these words in the midst of seeing all of the difficulty around him and the circumstances that would make him go, God, are you faithful? Here's what he says. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness, O God. This morning, you may need somebody to pray with. At the end of the service, I trust that you'll avail yourself of the opportunity to ask somebody to pray for you if your heart has been wandering and not faithfully walking. If you've been waiting and struggling with the faithfulness of God, bring that to the Lord in prayer with somebody this morning that you might find hope and encouragement. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you so much for your word. Thank you, Lord, that you are so faithful to us. Lord, your grace is so great. Thank you for your mercy and your kindness, and that your faithfulness is new every morning. Great is your faithfulness, O God. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Amen. Would you stand?
Great is your faith.
Our God is faithful. What an encouraging message and a reminder that He's faithful to His promises. He's faithful to His plan. And He's faithful to us, His people. You know, one of my favorite promises of God is that He will never leave us or forsake us. That's something that we should keep at the forefront of our minds, especially in the waiting, right? Sometimes in the waiting, it can seem like He has forsaken us, but He hasn't. Do you guys believe that? We serve a faithful God who loves us and sees us no matter what we're going through. Praise the Lord for that, right? If you're having a tough time and you're in the waiting, you know, we want to pray for you. As followers of Christ, we bear one another's burdens, right? And so we'll have people up front. Pastor Cory mentioned in the back. We'll have them wherever you need them if you need prayer. Don't leave without getting that, all right? Also, remember, next week is our Christmas services, so invite someone to that. And if this is your first time joining us today, I want an opportunity to meet you. So I'll be in the lobby after service. And remember, as we go out on mission for the Lord, remember that He is faithful and you are loved. Have a great week.